start out with, our audience is made up of a number of marine and watershed scientists. So what is it about this field, specifically marine and watershed science, that makes it conducive to integrating art? And we'll start here at this end, the watershed sculpture. We'll let you guys answer first.
So of course we're both versed in science, and we both have studied in science. What we are, you know, to be honest, we look at it differently. We can't work without scientific input, is the way we look at it. We can't make our work authentic and true until we have that. So there's, we often get questions from people that say, oh, your work looks like that famous guy that's in all the museums and plays with petals and leaves and things. And it's true, the work is beautiful when it starts, but we also don't want to go overboard on the idea that it has a great purpose. So sometimes conflicted, but we realize that we serve science with the work we do, but it also means that we have to have that fuel, that need, it's not only problem solution, but it's a real way to look at the world. And then we engage at that point with our aesthetic perspective. And, you know, it's very similar to, I think we're all somewhat in a similar field, in that data, that science, that reality affects what we actually create as far as sculpture and
really puts
on
the
land.
Yeah.
Anybody else? I'll
say it. I don't think it's necessary. Necessarily for my practice, specific to marine and watershed. Just, I'm super interested in water, because I think it's kind of the key to life, and it's my own personal interest. But that doesn't mean that other kinds of science aren't also being represented or interpreted as well. I'm starting a project using genetic modification of wheat and a wheat breeding for a perennial crop soon. So it's like not related to water at all. So it's a process or a methodology that can explore a lot of different ideas as well. But water is still my personal passion. Yeah.
I think for me it's about, because it's a sense of place. You know, and when I first learned about the concept of a watershed, I thought it was amazing. This idea of like what really makes a place, and that every body of water is a story, you know, its whole trajectory into the ocean, and that confluence of all the stories, that's the ocean. And so it's, they're metaphors for each other, and it's so fascinating and beautiful. Love it.
For me, just having a background in marine biology, I think, you know, the ocean is a really beautiful place, and a lot of people feel very connected to it. So having a way to use art to communicate that beauty with other people is really nice. And I haven't worked in any sort of watershed illustrations, but just from my background in science, you know, watersheds are a community. Communities use them. Everyone uses them. So it's a good platform for using art to communicate with the public, I think, because everybody uses it, yeah. They have some sort of connection to it, and so they can find a personal connection to artwork that is derived from that.
Absolutely. So where in this field, you know, marine and watershed science or other fields of science, where are some of the entry points that artists and science can collaborate together to improve communication or understanding of whether it be ocean issues or other environmental issues? In your experiences, you know, what do those collaborations look like, and how can they help in kind of some of the issues that the world is facing? And I'll give that to Enid.
Well, one interesting thing that I got to do the last few years before my retirement is curating all the art and science programs for the Bay Delta Conference series that then has transformed to this Riparian Conference series. And it was really interesting the first year, and you know, it was amazing because there's
honestly, there's more refreshments in this lobby than there will be at any like arts and humanities event that I will go to all year combined, right? So there's just, you know, there's a lot of resources there. And it was like, oh, we get to, you know, the first year we did a lot of technology, we had a lot of screens, and we had a lot of digital material coming at people and people making, you know, interesting modeling and films and the stuff. And then there was one artist who brought these costumes of pinnipeds. And you could, and it was in the middle of this really formal science poster giant conference thing. And I should have put a picture in it. And so nobody would get in them. So of course, me and my family got in them. Obviously, we are performative. And we were being pinnipeds all over the science. And that sort of changed everyone's. And then we had a panel discussion, and everyone wore these giant paper mache. It was like this, except everyone was wearing giant paper mache hats of indigenous species. Like there was a big steelhead salmon, and it changed. And then we had a sing-along, and so the sing-along to Tuolumne, but like it was all Tuolumne, like all of me, Tuolumne. Why not take Tuolumne? So you know, that kind of stuff actually changed and disrupted the conference in a way that was gentle and amusing, and so I think like art is like it changes your kind of mindset of what you're looking at, right? You see it through a new lens. And so the thing that became clear was that the lower tech interventions, and this is what I was starting to try and say about kind of broader impacts when you're writing those proposals, you know, thinking about ways that are maybe, it was so much cheaper the next year when we realized that's the stuff that was really working. Because we all are staring at screens all the time, right? So doing that kind of more creative interaction, finding that ways to do that together, I think, is really exciting.
How artists and scientists can collaborate. What I've seen is maybe a small example, but artists are trained, you know, in school and whatever, to have a lot of in-progress feedback and this critique process that I think is really powerful and humbling and really helpful in directing a project as it's progressing. And I, as far as I know, there's not a lot of scientists who are trained to engage in that kind of process. And from what I've seen, it's a lot of times you can't present your work until it's published or until you're going like ready to present it. And I think that that might be one small way that that scientists and like the methodologies between science and art can really influence each other in beneficial ways. And in the same ways, artists that engage with broader ideas about the real world that we live in, which is the main reason I'm interested in using scientific data in the first place. It having a reference to something that's really meaningful and impactful and is important knowledge to know, I think a lot of artists could gain from learning more about the world they live in. I think there's a question.
So I was wondering, how do you price your work? You know, say you make an illustration for a scientist, or how do you market yourself so that we can seek you out and realize what we're in for? Because we also are looking at a budget kind of thing, and so I'm just curious on how that connection is made.
Yeah. Okay. I guess I'll take that. Yeah. So a lot of the work that I've done up until now has been more just of a collaboration and not for a lot of monetary return yet. but I'm trying to get into that. And I do recognize from a scientist's perspective that there's pretty limited funds for things outside of your own research. And so I personally think that it's getting ahead of the game and setting aside money or asking in a grant for money specifically for, you know, outreach through art, through music, through any sort of art really, that's gonna educate the public. And so I don't know how to write that into a grant, but I'm hoping that some scientists do.
you when you know that you have a project that you're writing a proposal for, and you maybe you know there's an artist or an using that term broadly, that you want to work with, It's a good idea to have a meeting and talk about, you know, specifically you're talking about, in a way, science communication, and it can manifest itself through different art forms. It'd be more like, you know, gallery art or museum art or, you know, participatory art, or it can be in the landscape. But as you sit down, you can break down with the artists the real costs in terms of materials, and then sort of a reasonable percentage of your grant that could go towards just their time. And it's never going to compensate us, right, for the time.
but maybe you. No.
Yeah, but you know, it's something. Like, you know, people tend to put, like, for just to give you, like, for like a web based thing, like, you know, having $8,000 is like a nice thing. Having between $5,000 and $10,000 of a larger science grant that you put towards communication and broader impacts, I think is a good idea.
Other places for collaborations?
Well, when you talk about the funding of a project, and you know what that entails, and how are you going to relate to a science group and an art group, and you come together over a project is how you meet, and it's really awkward sometimes, and the first person that has ideas about getting funding usually leads the group and has a path to follow. So it seems to be awkward at first, but to get to know and to get a scientist to inform you, deeply inform you, so that you can come up with either a solution or an interpretation, it's really awkward at first. We have found working with scientists, and a lot of it is a function of the funding. When we have a funder that is a philanthropist or it's a grant, something like that, and it's coming to us and we find the scientists, it's a different situation than if the Nature Conservancy is working with us. You know, so there's
and they have budget for that.
Yeah, and they have budget for it. So it's a real trick to get it off the ground, because it's not taught, and they're two separate disciplines, and it's this kind of conference that brings it together and gets us to understand each other a little bit.
And for us, because our work is in place, we don't spin off editions or have. You know, a lot of the work shown in gallery except to illustrate the project. It does take us a long time. Sometimes it takes 9 months to negotiate the contract.
We've negotiated the contract for over a year.
Yeah, and so there's a lot of trust in that and expenses to just bring us up there to give us, you know, or wherever it is to give our time. But we get paid. We make a living as artists, and we... the best collaboration we have with scientists is they realize we're professionals as well, and we need to be paid, we need to be written into grants in order to do the work we do. And so we feel we have that value to a project. It's not maybe a large part of a project, but there's got to be a line item for that. And at our point in our profession, we don't really give away much of our work, but we do have a lot of lead up time, so that you hope, you know, as you build relationships,
you hope you get
that collaboration works. And sometimes you get so far and you realize this isn't going to work for whatever reasons, not just budget, but
you've invested a lot of time.
Yeah, so you give that time away, don't have things to take away from that. So it's just something that what we see when we do work with scientists, our first step is in a boardroom, is in an office, poring over charts, data, designs that they've come up with. And then it's important for us to do our homework so we can match that knowledge with how we interpret it.
Oh, no, I just was very enthusiastic. Yeah.
And that actually leads beautifully into our next question, which is, what are some of the challenges of integrating art and science? And from those challenges, how do we get better at it? How do we address them?
Well, one of the challenges is, in working with scientists, is they've really put, as an artist, we put work into maybe images or ideas, conceptual intentions. A scientist does a research and has their science, and it's theirs, and you want to know about it. Well, they have egos too, you know. So there's an exchange that goes on that is a challenge, and the better you can communicate and understand each other, that I don't want this research to go use it against you. I want us to work together to actualize the research, and let's see if it works. What can we apply to it to make it work as not just an object and an idea, but maybe something that is actually reduces siltation in a landscape.
And I think some of the best collaborations that we've had are science professionals willing to give us information, but beyond that is knowing the information we may need. Because we don't know sometimes. We'll come into something and it will be something we've not studied before.
We spend most of our time getting informed.
Yeah, but we can ramp up pretty quickly. But it's the team that says, you need to know about this study, or you need to know about this history of this. Then we can go off and pull the data and get up to speed with what is germane to the problem or the project. But and it's funny, sometimes we'll just say, just dump it on us. And they don't. A lot of people don't think we're going to sit there and read through these things, but we do.
Yeah.
And then, and you know, and you were saying there's so much on the web, so you kind of get a scent of something or a feeling, and you know, we'll just exploit things on the web, and sometimes we'll come back to, oh, he was in the room the other day. Here is his paper, or she did this. So it's knowing maybe what we would need as artists to help visualize what's happening in that scientific process.
Yeah, I completely agree with that. I think if you're a scientist wanting to work with an artist, specifically speaking as a science illustrator, so working with a science illustrator, for example, knowing, having kind of an idea of what you want at the end, having a good solid foundation of information that you can pass on to an illustrator is really important. And I know that it's difficult probably as non-artists sometimes to visualize what you want the end product to look like. We totally understand that, I think. And that's our job, right, is to visualize it and put it into some sort of visual platform for you. But yeah, being very clear about what your needs are and what your goals are, I think is very important when you're approaching an artist to work with them.
I think for me, it's the challenge has just been about time, where, you know, I get a phone call and it's like this really interesting idea and the grant deadline is in like 7 days. And, you know, I think science and art, long ago, medieval times, you know, we were in the same college at the university. Like we're investigative, you know, we're experimenting with the world and trying to understand it. And so when we have enough time to do that together, you know, like maybe a month out, just before the grant's due. Like that, for me, that's it. That's the real, because I actually, once we get, it's so much fun. And, but you know, any kind of collaboration, sort of like knowing your stuff and knowing what you're good at, gives you the confidence to be in a collaborative thing. And then, you know, different people have different communication skill sets. And so, you know, getting to where you're in a good communication with each other is just that basic thing. It's because it's like time and communication, like any collaboration. But I think, you know, especially in a lot of the colleges in this area, they're represented here, a lot of us are teaching and doing research and creative work, so we do need that a little more leeway.
I would say communication is a huge part of it. Sometimes the terminology between art and science is so specific and specialized, it's really hard to just have a base conversation. So I've sort of been compiling a list of good questions as like a guidebook to help me in those collaborations. And one of the first ones is usually just figuring out exactly why you became passionate about the thing that you're studying, because there's always a human story behind where you ended up and why you're studying, you know, marine science or whatever it is. And that's a really human level that all people can connect on. And so one of my first questions as well for scientists, no matter who I meet, is can you explain your science to someone who knows nothing about it? Sometimes that's like, can you explain it to your grandma or like a seven-year-old? And it's so important to be able to do that, because no matter what the impact of what you're studying, if you can't communicate it to the general public, then that's when we're just swimming in information, but we don't actually gain any knowledge from it. It's just some ground, like finding common ground is a challenge. And then once that's established, having science, because I'm not specifically an illustrator, I'm not just illustrating science for the means of a scientist. I'm sort of asking questions and having my own exploratory process. I think having a scientist be open to whatever that process might end up at is really important for me personally. I think it doesn't necessarily apply to someone who is illustrating science, which is absolutely a wonderful practice too, but it's just a little bit different than the process I take. Science is typically about answering a specific question. For me, art is about asking questions and not necessarily finding a solution. It's about exploring the idea and letting it take you where it goes. So those are some differences in the practices that I've seen, that it's nice to be open to all methodologies.
But it's that what you were saying about passion, you know, that what I found that we're in the process of that and we're involved in with a group of scientists, it's when they finally reveal to us like what that spark is, and it's maybe not the end all and be all, but what that spark is, when we finally figure that one out and we understand what that person's doing, it's just as exciting for us, because we are very passionate, but we know scientists are very passionate about their works. We're just trying to get into your heads and go, what started you, or what that spark is, or what's the end result, or what was a good day in the lab? It kicks off a whole series of things for us. When we go home after figuring that out, it just starts a whole process that's very visual, but it's going to be reflected in the work that we do as artists then. That passion, letting us into that that spark that happens when you discover something or put things together or on the right path for where you want to be in your process. It is reflected in what an artist does. And I think it's reflected in all the arts we saw tonight. I mean, I could see it with the illustrations with the moth that goes in there, and I'm trying to figure out how many seeds they're eating. And all of that is, I think it's very exciting for artists to be able to reveal that first to ourselves, but then we reveal it to other audiences.
And get them excited about it.
Yeah, and get them excited.
Yeah. I mean, just listening to you talk, I was thinking, like, we're only 10 years away about from a period where, you know, scientists were being marginalized almost to the point that artists are in society, you know, during the Bush administration, you know, like talking about scientific data in relation to making policy or making decisions. Was just kind of not allowed to happen. And I feel like there has been this real depression of science communication in our society, and we are in big trouble. So we've got to get better at this. And I mean, I am definitely passionate about what the scientists find personally passionate. I'm also just passionate about it. I think it's so important and so incredibly amazing. And,
a lot of communication is key.
Yeah, there has to be a way to break through. You know, once that nut is cracked,
yeah,
it's really exciting and fulfilling to
kind of make the world better.
So on the exciting and fulfilling thread, I wanted to ask how the art science integration, how that space has influenced each of you personally? And I know many of you hit on some of that in your talks, but specifically, how has that kind of that space of the boundary of art and science influenced you personally?
I didn't really talk about that today. I usually talk about it a little bit, but I'm from a community where women are really discouraged from being scientists. I was really interested in being a scientist. I was in like advanced and AP science courses, and I was sort of made to stop taking them. And I think something that I think about a lot is how, you know, there is a lack of diversity in the sciences, and there are still like, a lot of communities that do exclude or discourage girls or just, you know, anyone from becoming part of the sciences. It's not a normal thing to be. And I think for me, talking about the natural world and in relationship to my loving the sense of place, I think, which is so powerful, it's a way for me to really continue to think along those lines and to learn about a discipline that I would have liked to have pursued, I think, in my life more. It's funny, you know, I was working on a project about the Central Valley where they have land subsidence. And I had been reading about it and reading about it and reading about it. And, you know, of course, I didn't know how to pronounce it. So when I first finally went to a watershed scientist out there to talk about land subsidence, it took us a while to figure out what we were both talking about. But it's because, you know, it's you know, it's amazing. You can learn a lot from reading, but really working together is the most educational thing.
I have a similar experience. Only for me, it was generational.
Yeah.
You know, girls didn't study science. My high school, they offered one biology class, one chemistry class, and I avoided both of them. And I could. I took French. Like, how did that work out? But so when I finally, in college, came around to science again, it was a little late, but I got very turned on about it. And career-wise, when I realized that I could actually get into that in many ways, and you know, even when I was making films, that I could do that. Then, you know, it was kind of like I mourned all the courses that I didn't take and just got busy, you know, catching up and trying to get above that curve. And I like your thing about, you know, make sure you're pronouncing things right. I try to kind of hover before I talk. Just so I know, how are they saying that?
Well, you know, I just, my husband is a writer, he also mispronounces a lot of words, and I've realized that, you know, we didn't grow up around a lot of people who are reading these kind of things, and that I read somewhere, never look down on someone for mispronouncing a word, because it means they learned it from reading.
I'll use that next time I mispronounce something.
For me, the integration of art and science has, I mean, personally, it's so fulfilling because it's like the marriage of two things that I've always loved since I was a child and have both allowed me, like art and science have both allowed me to explore things always. Mm-hmm. And they're kind of different, but they're also not. And I think a lot when I was in school and studying both of the different disciplines, people would say, oh, like you're double majoring in science and art? That's kind of a weird, like, so how cool. Different are those things? And I'm like, well, they're actually really similar.
Which parties did you go to?
Actually, it's really good.
She was too busy studying.
Exactly. but yeah, for me, it's that exploration and fascination with the natural world and being able to explore it through both pathways of science and art, and then both of them as well combined. So yeah, I guess it's fulfilling for me personally, and then it's also, I feel fulfilled when someone else can explore science through my art as well, and mm-hmm. see something in a different way that they can't normally observe things.
Yeah, I often get asked if I collect my own data, and I don't have any interest in doing that. I find it more intriguing to mine other people's data and then connect to them that way. And I don't want to be an expert, because as soon as you're an expert, I think you stop asking stupid questions. And I love asking stupid questions and being humble about it. So, I think integration, I guess for me personally, is like I get to be excited and interested and learn about a ton of different scientific things and different research that's happening, but it's so broad that it just keeps the passion for making the things that I make going forward. I'll stick to the
what,
like,
you know.
The stuff I know is like making things physically, working in the shop. Like, I love all of those things and working with material and in a way that is its own science, you know, trying different
interpretation.
Yeah, different water, like seeing how different waters like cast, you know, when you freeze them. It's all sort of a scientific process, but by no means to the level of what real scientists do. So,
And you're making things that are, I mean, they're so beautiful, and they take these really ephemeral moments, you know, like the history of a fire, or like the, you know, experience of this meandering river, and you make this very solid feeling of permanence, which I think is really, really interesting. It's really beautiful.
Yeah.
One common
thing. I love how yours is totally ephemeral. So I just have to say, like, I love too that, like, you guys will walk up to a bank of trees and be like, "That's our sculpture. That is so great. Like, I love it."
Thank you. Because some people don't get that.
Oh, man.
That we think it's still, we know it's still there.
Well, do they ask if it's still art? Like, how is that art? Do they ever ask you that?
Oh, yeah.
Well, it's an ephemeral process. So as you make the art, and as it works with its biological trajectory, the artist, as time goes on, the artist's presence is less and less apparent. It loses its identity as a handmade object at some point, and that's really exciting for us, is to find that point where it loses its identity as a handmade object. You go there and you can still see it, but it'll be gone the next time you come there. And we can go through some of our sites where there are 10 pieces and walk a visitor through, and they'll never see. We just passed 10, so did you see them?
Yeah, we can see the bones of them, but that's where that's the most exciting moment, because that's where it's becoming the remedial work we had thought it would be. So that's where, you know, the trees or whatever that's happening, or the fish are populating more, it really starts to happen. But we have had managers write us and say, "Oh, so glad the leaves are changing and falling off. I can now see your sculpture again." Well, in a couple of years, you won't see anything but trees. So that's, you know.
One common thread with artists and scientists is there's a large degree of social responsibility. That's why we're here. We pretty much grew up, every generation has tragedies that have happened environmentally. We grew up, the Great Lakes were polluted. I don't know how many of you remember that. The bay has been polluted and has come back to a degree, you know. So there's a lot of social responsibility that brings us together, and that's probably the initial attraction with a scientist and an artist, and pretty much keeps them on track.
Well, I
want to
open it up to some audience questions as well. If anybody has a question, we have a few minutes left before we release you all for our last refreshments and happy hour. Does anybody have a question? Yeah.
This is for Adrian. Do you use your pieces to educate the public as well? Do you put them on in public spaces so that they see them?
And I'm going to repeat the question just in case people in the back can't hear. So the question was for Adrienne about whether she uses her pieces for education for the public as well.
Yeah, I think a huge part of my work is the narrative behind it and presenting it really, like, I've presented a lot this year, and to data visualization people, to art people, to like a broad range, and that's one way that it really is educational. I do show my work, but primarily most people see things online nowadays, and that's how you're going to reach your broadest audience. So usually people can tell that there's something driving the form, And that leads to the inquiry. And usually the pieces are titled something that relates to the data. So like the Canyon piece is called Trends in Water Use, because that's a scientific report that, same title. So it sort of tells you that there's something going on, and then people get to seek out the information behind the piece. So on my website, there's all of the source, pretty much everything I show plus more, all of the source data, a description of where I got the data, usually links to the original data source, and then the whole process of making the piece. But getting the work out there and like getting it to a broad audience is, I think, a challenge. But I like that my work is able to reach beyond arts specifically, because it incorporates data and it incorporates science and it incorporates materials. So there's a way to engage people from a lot of different areas through the mediums that we work with. And I think each of our works can be seen in that, engaging different audiences. And that's the most important part. You know, you're all in this room because you're interested in environmental arts and sciences, but to reach people who wouldn't have even think to come here or to think about art and science in that way or to use it as a way to be educated about the environment is super powerful. So it's a challenge, but getting it out there is to as many people as possible is a really important part of it.
Yeah, it is. what do you do with all your pieces, you know? I mean, to get it out there, it's a whole another challenge for an artist. That doesn't even relate to working with scientists. So there's this whole other world that an artist kind of lives in with these pieces, whereas scientists can put a lot of projects in a briefcase. An artist can't put a lot of projects in a room like this. I mean, they just accumulate year after year after year after year. So how many pieces do you have in your apartment?
Many, actually. I do show work at different museums, and usually it's specific to like a theme. So like sometimes I'll show pieces that are in a show about data art. Sometimes it'll be about like science. So I had a piece at the Oakland Museum of California last year that had to do with the bay, you know, in general. And so seeing what context the pieces end up in when they are exhibited is really interesting.
Oh, it's really, it's different. So.
Yeah, so yeah, physical work. I'm able to like, I don't make a ton of stuff, and I'm able to sell the pieces that I do make here and there. So that really.
So there are objects that you build and you can they tend to leave.
Yeah, and I do make things in additions occasionally. So I've made multiples of something. The Tide piece, I've made three of them. One was a public 1% for the arts that went to Alaska and was showing tides specific to Kachemak Bay where I did that residency. So I'll make additions and change the data when I can. I've made two snow cabinets. I'll never make another one. It's way too complicated to make. Which definitely helps because it's really hard to, like, the process to actually come up with an idea and make a piece. Like, you're saying it's like a year for a contract. It's like a year for a piece for me usually.
Yeah.
So coming up with a brand new idea every single time isn't always the best. But it is a way to just keep exploring ideas for sure. And I mean, you guys are in a particular place because your work is integrated into the landscape. So in terms of showing your work, do you like document, like Christos, not you, like document everything and then like show?
Yeah, of course photography, because that's how it lives on and so people see it that way. But also Daniel makes lots of models, and some of them get shown, some of them are finished models, some of them, you know, sit on our kitchen counter for, you know, months at a time and then eventually get integrated but drawing, sketching, mapping. We have lots of flat files full of the work that we need to do in order to make the installation. And sometimes that gets seen and a lot of times it doesn't get seen. The internet is great for that because, you know, you one day say, hey, no one's ever seen this data, and slap it on Facebook. Yeah. So that's kind of nice, and it keeps things going. But
I think the biggest thing we've learned in the last 10 years with doing work and collaborations and working with scientists that when the project is finished, they go off with paperwork, and we go off with our work left there. It seems to working with a scientist who's, you know, they're walking away. We're not really walking away with the work, but what we've learned in the last 10 years is we've found an archivist and an archive museum that will take it and go through it, and so it's everything's archived. We don't even keep work anymore. Yeah. It just goes to the museum and it's archived for research.
And for other people to learn. I just wanted to say one thing about the titles and some of your works. It's very nice we're at this point in art and science integration that we feel that artists now can just title their works the way they want to title their works. And when you're working with a lot of science, sometimes it's just a descriptor. It's not a creative, hooky, tricky title. And we really got busted for a long time, many years ago, with, well, it's just not creative enough, that title. And we didn't give into that, but I think it's finally starting to catch up that you can say, a study about watersheds, and that's exactly what this piece is. And it is a piece of art, and it has a lot of science in it. And when we first started doing that, it was kind of scary for us because we didn't really want people to say, is it art? You know, we wanted them to see it as art, but that was very specific to a process or a place or a problem or just a creek. You know, we wanted them to realize that it's really placed there and it's really responding to that. So now I like it when I see art just titled what it actually is, a study of this or whatever. Anyway, just had a comment on that.
I'll take maybe one more question.
Yeah. So as a scientist who both does research and a teacher, tackling climate change and having to talk about climate change in the classroom, Ian and I was really struck by how you said that you weren't allowed to use climate change or global warming, and just thinking about how, like, I just gave a talk at a Kiwanis Club meeting on Wednesday and talked to them about climate change.
I've talked there.
Yeah, I don't know that I would have been able to talk to them without using the term climate change. I think it's just really interesting to think that art is a way to not have to put words on something. So I just was wondering if, like, all of you, you know, had something to comment just about if you have had experiences where you have presented art about something like climate change or some sort of difficult topic that that you really saw connections with the people who were witnessing art or experiencing there.
I'm not going to try to repeat all of that.
Well, I actually learned something at the last time we gave a talk, and it was for Earth Day. There was an author, and I wish I could remember her name, but she actually talked to us about how climate change is now a softening of what's really happening, which is global warming. And I remember that. Now, why did we all start changing? Well, there's a lot of political reasons why climate change is a softening of global warming, and it's a more accepted term. So now we're saying sea level rise or sea rise or seas heightening. It's hard. You know, yeah, sea change. Thank you. Now talk about distilling something down. You know, sea change could mean anything. But people hear what they want to hear. We all know, you know, that in this country that, you know, you hear what you want to hear out of something. And I feel that artists and scientists should be free to tell it like it is. One of the worst experiences I've ever had, and I probably blew it for us, but we had a conference room and interviewing us, and some fellow stepped up and said, I understand you probably are really impromptu when you do your work. And I just had this visceral reaction. I just leaned forward and said, there's nothing impromptu at all about it when we're out there. And I realized, you know, he just thought
we danced out there and kind of,
you know, playing in the daisies or something out there. And I totally overreacted to it, but you know, I just, misunderstanding is probably maybe a misunderstanding on my part of what his intentions were, which I still can't figure out. But I just think if we feel like something should be called global warming, that, you know, I mean, unless under contract we're asked not to talk that way, and then that brings up things, that we should be able to do that, and we should have audiences like you challenging us on that, because that is part of the process, that where we sit in the worlds that we sit in, that if we see more and more people starting to distill what we are reacting to, like it's not there anymore, then what's our reaction all about? In other words, if glacial melting is soft pedal to, well, it'll give us more water, more fresh water, what's really happening is, you know, the world's heating up and we're losing glaciers forever, you know. So we should be able to talk about that. Having to be, you know, censored.
I don't feel like I was censored, first of all, and I definitely take responsibility for using accurate terminology with my work. I do think climate change is an accurate terminology for the complexity of the shifting climate and the fact that some areas are going to have really cold winter storms. And there was a lot of confusion about that in Congress and everywhere else, this idea that like, oh, well, look at this snowball. I think it is important for us to sort of think about, okay, yeah, these words do have meaning. And I actually ended up calling that exhibition Sea Change before that was an accepted terminology, because I liked the metaphor of it. But then what I came to learn was that it wasn't just that some areas are going to get wetter, some areas are going to get drier. Mm-hmm. And that's also a big problem. So I think it's important to, I don't see them as soft pedaling phrases. I see them as like becoming more accurate. The idea of not using global warming in talking about in the Sea Change show was definitely a political decision that the head of this Nature Interpretation Center was making, because that this Nature Interpretation Center that's really going to be underwater soon, like literally, there was a moment where we had made a model of the landscape out of wood. You would have liked it, and it had blocks which were like houses, and it was in this big sink. And you could turn it on, and it would slowly flood the landscape. And children could try and figure out ways to build structures that they could then live in, children in the community. And it was really cool that they were also engaged in it, but also made me cry when I thought about it later, because, you know, they're thinking about this. And then and there was like this moment where it really crystallized for my daughter, like what we were actually doing. And it was pretty profound.
Sad.
Yeah, and so, I mean, I feel sometimes, like, I understand the data, and I understand, you know, when my husband is talking about, like, well, you know, let's be sure and try and, we can still turn this around, and I don't know that that's true, you know, like, I know also the dangers of saying, you know, hey, you know, enjoy it while it lasts. let's party like it's 1999. I mean, it's just that balance of like, you know, we don't actually know all the answers to remind ourselves, and that we do need to speak in a way that includes everybody. And when you look at politically like where our country is, there are people who literally do not share the same set of data that we share. Like my brother-in-law, you know, a very conservative evangelical Christian. He believes that there were weapons of mass destruction in Iraq. He believes that George Bush was a very effective and popular president, you know, because his sources of information are totally different than mine. And so it's so hard to even have a conversation.
Yeah.
Like where we're sharing, like President Obama says, let's all agree on some basic facts. And like, we're not there, obviously. Sunday. Oh my God, are you ready? Like, you know, so it's how do we get there? You know, like that, I am super interested in that because I see these little kids who are trying to figure this stuff out. And if we shut it off, it's like, ooh.
Has anybody heard in these debates and in this in this, has anybody heard anything about
400 parts per million.
You know, anything about anything under the umbrella of environmentalism. It's not a discussion. It's never been discussed. And it usually is. There's somebody that takes a position on it. That not this election.
Donald Trump's bus was very cold.
Oh wait.
The air conditioning.
No, Chinese conspiracy.
So,
conversations can we continue at happy
hour? Yeah, I think that's very good.
But I want to be mindful of time because we're over already. So I want to give our speakers a big round of applause.